So Ania, when we first started this at the very beginning a couple of weeks ago, everybody had to introduce themselves, talk for a minute or two on what you're doing, right? What's going on with your program here, and then something that you're very proud of that you've accomplished in the last few years. Yeah, so let me just sort of open up class and say thanks for coming today, and I hope this is going to be a very interesting day because it's certainly one that we're going to talk a lot about creativity of innovation and innovations and things along those lines. It's been a couple of weeks, so everybody also had a chance to maybe work on their assignment related to coming up with a new idea for a business or product line or something along those lines, so I'm looking forward to seeing how that works out. Let me introduce our newest student today, Ania. I'm going to turn it over to you for a few minutes and maybe give us a little background on yourself.
Okay. So my name is Ania, and I'm an exchange student from University of Stuttgart. Mm-hmm. So I'm doing my master's thesis now at Aerospace Department, and actually I'm studying electrical engineering and computer technology.
Okay.
So what is... Yeah, for the first time in USA, and I'm now since two months is in USA, I mean Boulder.
Uh-huh.
So, yeah. Yeah, what is?
What is something you're very proud of? Maybe your first time in the USA. Maybe that's
a
good step.
Yeah, this is something that I'm really proud of that, and then, yeah.
Well, congratulations, and welcome to Boulder. It's a nice place to be here. That's right.
It's the University of
Stuttgart. Yeah.
Sort of southern Germany-ish?
Yep. Stuttgart is Stuttgart in English.
Stuttgart.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, and that's where southern Germany, more or less, sort of.
Yeah, sort of.
Yeah. Home of Mercedes, right?
That's right. Home of Porsche and Mercedes.
There you are. I know that part of it.
I work in Mercedes as a student.
Yes.
So this is maybe something that I can be proud of there.
Yeah, I think so. Well, this is a great class to come for the first time because we're going to talk about innovation. We're going to talk about why innovation is so important from a corporate perspective. We're going to talk about the innovation process, how one actually can be innovative and creative, and lots of examples along the way of what's gone on in the past. So for the objective today, one, it's very easy to see why innovation from a corporate perspective is so important for growth and sustaining success of any company. We're going to talk about many different types of innovations, from small continuous improvements to very large market disrupting technologies. And we're going to look at some of the literature, the critical literature that's out there, one by Peter Drucker and one by Clayton Christensen, that really talked about what innovation is, creativity, the aha moment, or is it something other than that? Very important, and I think give us all hope that we can also be as creative as necessary. So today, the goal really is all about demonstrating that we all have the capacity to be innovative. It's not just a few lucky people that get to have all the right brain cells pointing in the right direction for things like this. We all have the capacity to do this. And sometimes it's just being able to see the opportunity that's right in front of us from a slightly different point of view. So let me start. Again, we covered last week sort of the different elements of the innovation process. Today we're going to continue focusing on recognizing the opportunity. And let's just start with something that we left on 2 weeks ago, and that was the idea of the movie Slingshot, which was this biography of Dean Kamen and his research company called Deca Research. So if you remember last time around, we had this discussion about Dean Kamen, and if you remember, Dean Kamen is the inventor of the Segway, that little two-wheel device that goes around, but most of his money was made from a corporate standpoint in the area of medical devices that he sold to other people. So the kind of things that we talked about are what motivates Kamen. Is he really an inventor or an innovator? What about his strengths and what are his weaknesses and how did he compensate for all them? And is DECA innovation process a freeform kind of thing or is it somewhat more structured? A lot of this went on the film. We actually watched a whole documentary in here last time around about this. And I always liked the film for lots of different reasons, but if you go through the film, and I've now looked at it 5 times, so another time after the one that we saw last time, and I pulled out these little quips that I thought were really good, and certainly that I thought were very important. So from Kamen's perspective, I call these Kamenisms, if you will. From Kamen's perspective, one of the things that he always talked about is, I like solving big problems. And I think there was even one point in there where he says, the crazier other people think you are for solving these big problems, the bigger you know the problem is. And I thought that was great. What really motivates him? He had mentioned at one point that if you can empty half of all the beds in all the hospitals in the entire world by giving clean people or giving people clean water, why wouldn't we want to go ahead and do that? And then he had another comment in here that said something to the effect of, I want to say to the world that I worked on a really big problem. I didn't solve it, but at least I tried. And I thought that's a lot of what we do as engineers. Sometimes these problems are really big. We don't necessarily solve them the way we'd like to, but at least we tried to solve them. And sometimes we can get partly the get part of the answer, and then somebody else might have an insight and get the rest of the answer. So you don't necessarily have to take it all the way to the end, but you at least have to carry it somewhat further so that somebody else has a chance to do it as well. And then there's this comment that he made about, I'm an inventor. And what do? Inventors look at problems, but the same problems everybody else look at, but they just see them slightly differently. And that by itself is a very creative process as well. So I think I'm going to post, I have a whole page of these things now that I put through. I'm going to post them on D2L so you can take a look at them if something you might want to carry on in the future. Remember, we talked just briefly about the idea of an invention versus an innovation. And from an invention standpoint, we said that an invention is really the discovery of something new, whether it's a new idea, a new good or a service or a technology or something along those lines, something that's never been done before. And you can patent it, you can sort of protect it as a trade secret. We'll talk about those issues certainly in a couple of weeks. But the innovation side of that is taking that invention and actually doing something with it to create value for the customers that are willing to pay money for that. And that's the difference. So even we had a lot of different ways of describing this. I think it, for me, it came down to something really quite simple in that innovation is just the idea of invention plus commercializing that to make it valuable to society. Why is it important? Well, it's not too surprising. You can see a lot of people talking about innovation throughout their entire corporate history. Here's the CEO of John Deere, for example, saying, John Deere's ability to keep inventing new products that are useful to customers is still the key to the company's growth. So obviously, even John Deere, which is a tractor company, is looking at new ways of doing things that really help their customers get their jobs done. Then there was a report that came out a couple of years ago by a consulting firm called A.D. Little. And what A.D. Little said is, everyone agrees that innovation is important, and study after study proclaims that companies are putting the creation of new innovative-based value at the heart of their business priorities. So what does that really mean? It means innovation is now becoming a corporate strategy, not just something that a few people do off in the lab someplace. Why is this so critical? One of the things that this report did is A.D. Little went out and surveyed a whole bunch of companies, figured out what their financial growth looked like, looked at how they actually manage innovation internally, and they came up with this index where they had the innovation success on this axis, and success is defined as profitability, ability to bring products to market in certain periods of time, as a function of what they called the index, which is the more innovative a company is, what's that really look like? And you can see here that very clearly the trend is upward that says the more innovative a company is, the better its overall success in the marketplace. And specifically, what the report brought through was that you can certainly have much higher profit levels from new products, so 13% greater profit by introducing some new products, but maybe even more important that they were able to reduce the break-even time, which is the amount of time it takes sort of to catch up with all the investment to make that product. How many do you have to sell before you break even and start making money? You reduce the number of the amount of time that it took to really make that happen. So at the end of the day, innovation is something we all need to make sure our companies are successful for the very long term. Not a big surprise. There was another study that PricewaterhouseCoopers came out with not too long ago called Unleashing the Power of Innovation. And if you'd like, I can put these studies on D2L as well if you want to take a look at it. They came up with a whole lot of things about, well, what are companies that are successful thinking about relative to innovation as a corporate strategy? And they came up with this really nice graphic that looks at, first of all, the more successful companies by almost 3-1 have innovation as a corporate strategy internally in their organization. And you can follow along with this. At the end of the day, what it really points out is that 62% of the companies are much better off financially for those that at least think innovation is an important place to be, relative to those that don't think innovation is an important place to be. So just in moving your company forward financially, innovation can play a significant role in how to do that. But we also know that you can do innovation as a driver of social change, for example. A few weeks ago, we showed a picture of this, which is Google's autonomous vehicle. And we talked about one of the motivations Google might have in actually developing an autonomous vehicle. But one of the things that the guy that's actually in charge of innovation at Google pointed out was, certainly it ties together a lot of things that Google does very well, but from his perspective, it all started with reading in The Economist, a magazine out of London, that more than 1 million traffic deaths a year are caused by human error, if you will. And if you could remove the human error element of driving a car, then all of a sudden you can save 1 million lives a year from accidents and what have you. Thus, Google's overall motivation might be somewhat altruistic in that they want to develop the autonomous vehicle so that they can do the right thing for society. And as we spoke last time, we also know that as they're sitting in the car for certain periods of time, we suspect that they'll probably be online Googling things, and therefore Google can actually get ad revenue while they're also doing something socially beneficial, which is a good thing. Well, Nissan is doing exactly the same thing, and if we were talking about Mercedes, we'd be talking about the same sort of thing that they're working on. But innovation as a driver of social change, Nissan is doing this exact same thing with their electric vehicles with an entire philosophy that's built around the environment, really talking about something called the symbiosis of people, vehicles, and nature. And they have a particular plan in place that they call their Green Plan, which looks at reducing the environmental impact of both corporate activities and a lot of their vehicles, promoting the application of green technologies. Excuse me. They have this chart that they'll show if you look at the sort of sustainability report within Nissan right now, that while if they didn't do anything, their overall CO2 footprint would be increasing with time as they sell more and more cars. They figure that if they can get more and more electric vehicles on the road, their overall peak CO2 emissions should come somewhere in the 2020s and then start to decrease after that as more and more of their fleet is now electrically driven. So not only are they going to work on what they can do at the corporate headquarters, for example, but by focusing on their electric vehicle fleet, they can actually have a positive impact on the environment. Well, we already know that somebody is, actually I was just talking with a gentleman a few minutes ago that has met this person. Has anybody heard about microfinance, microcredit? Have you heard of the company called Kiva? Okay, so let's talk about this. There's a very interesting idea that's been going on for about 25 years now about how can you really help the poor in the world. And a gentleman by the name of Muhammad Yunus, who is an economist, he's actually from Bangladesh. He's an economist, got his economics degree from someplace here in the States, and ended up winning the 2006 Nobel Peace Prize for this concept that he created called microfinance and microcredit. One of the things that he studied while he was doing his economics degree was, why is it that poor people basically stay poor through their whole lives and into the next generation? And he concluded that it has nothing to do with the people's ambition or their lack of education or anything like that, but for the most part, it was their lack of ability to actually get a loan to do something more beneficial with their life. The problem that most poor people have is that they can't go to a bank and say, can I have $1,000 to buy something to improve the quality of life of my family? Because the bank is going to say, well, sure, but what do you have in collateral? Show me your stock certificates. Show me your house that you own. Show me the car that you own. And of course, poor people don't have this. So it's a problem. They never get a loan for anything. Therefore, this whole cycle of poverty tends to continue. And Yunus took a look at this and said, no, wait a minute, if the whole problem with poverty is access to capital, access to money, why don't we just start some program that gives people access to money? And he created this thing called the Grameen Bank, otherwise known as the Village Bank, which looks a whole lot like this, where you have people throughout villages and in this particular region of Bangladesh that don't need a lot of money, small amounts of money can have a very huge impact on their lives. So they're borrowing things like $20 or $50 or $100, and all of a sudden buying a small spinning loom to be able to make yarn in order to make certain cloth and textiles, for example, that they can then sell to somebody else. And it doesn't take a lot of money to be able to start that process in a very positive way. So what I'd like to do at this point is just show you this YouTube. It's just a few minutes long, of what he did and what the whole microfinance and microcredit concept is. And let's see what you think, and we can talk about it when it's done. It takes a minute to load here with this whole system, so give it a second.
How much money does it take to change the world? How much money does it take to make real and lasting progress against global poverty? Would $1 billion be enough? $100 billion? For one man, it took just $27. $27 and a simple but compelling idea. That man is Muhammad Yunus, and his ideas started a global revolution that has brought hope, opportunity, and pride to some of the poorest people on earth. So, who is Muhammad Yunus? And what was his idea? To understand Muhammad Yunus, you need to know where he comes from. Bangladesh. Although Bangladesh is a beautiful country with a rich culture, it is one of the poorest and most densely populated nations in the world. Muhammad Yunus was born in Bangladesh in 1940, and he was affected by the dramatic conditions there. But unlike so many of his fellow Bangladeshis, Muhammad Yunus was not born into poverty, which gave him access to important opportunities. As a result, he was able to go to good schools, get a quality education, and even go to college. Eventually, he won a scholarship to study economics in the United States. While Muhammad lived in the United States, he witnessed something there that changed his life. He saw the historic struggles of the civil rights movement up close, and he was deeply affected. Muhammad was particularly inspired by the movement's powerful commitment to social justice, and it stayed with him. When Muhammad went back to Bangladesh, he continued to be profoundly concerned about issues of justice, especially poverty. And as an economist, he wondered why. Why was there so much deprivation in his country? Why were so many people living in so much misery? He quickly realized that unemployment was not the problem. In fact, most of the people living in poverty in Bangladesh were working. They worked full-time at back-breaking jobs. The real problem was wages. Muhammad Yunus came to a profound conclusion about poverty.
What creates poverty? What created this situation that human being has to be brought into this kind of situation where they have to beg for existence? Is this the fault of the person? Repeatedly, I come to the same conclusion. There is nothing wrong with the people. Poverty is not created by the poor people. Poverty is created by the system that we have built, the concepts that we have created. That's what created poverty.
As Professor Yunus studied the problem, he began to focus more and more on the issue of credit and the ability to get loans. With wages so low in Bangladesh, he realized the poor could never save up enough money to change their lives. The only way to rise out of poverty was to get access to capital. With loans, the poor could move to better neighborhoods, go to better schools, pay for college, get better jobs, even start their own businesses. But in Bangladesh, as in most countries, the poor do not have access to the kinds of loans that can change their lives. According to conventional wisdom, they are simply too great a risk. They have low incomes, no collateral, no history of credit, and belong to a group that is generally not regarded very highly. Fortunately, Professor Yunus was able to look beyond the attitudes of his time and challenge us to see the world's poorest people in a completely different light. And it all started with $27. In 1976, in the midst of a deep economic downturn, Professor Yunus left the comfort of the university where he taught and talked to poor villagers in the towns around his city. Although he didn't have much money, he realized it wouldn't take much money to completely transform people's lives. In an impulsive moment, Professor Yunus gave $27 from his own pocket to a small group of 42 craftsmen. But Professor Yunus made it clear to these craftsmen that the money was not a handout. He believed that charity only makes the poor dependent and vulnerable. Instead, it was to be a loan that they would have to pay back. And they were more than happy to comply. These craftsmen used the money to buy the supplies they needed to make and sell small crafts. They started their own business and paid back every single penny. And that's when Muhammad Yunus had his revolutionary insight. He realized that the smallest of loans could dramatically change the lives of the poor. In many cases, they just needed a little bit of cash to get some resources, materials for a small startup business that could give them a fighting chance. However, Professor Yunus knew that there was not a single bank in the country that would risk lending to the rural poor. So he took matters into his own hands, and this was the step that would start a revolution. Professor Yunus started his own bank, the Grameen Bank, focused on helping the poor. And he soon realized the demand for help was extraordinary. The Grameen Bank loaned small amounts of money, microloans, to a wide range of poor Bangladeshis, including farmers, craftsmen, and women, people who could not traditionally get loans. Some villagers bought dairy cows, then sold the milk to their neighbors, creating small sustainable businesses. Others used the money to open grocery stores or buy materials for making furniture. And then in some villages, people took out group loans to construct hand-powered wells that helped supply drinkable water for the entire community. In all of these cases, the benefits rippled throughout the village. Professor Yunus reinvented banking and got rid of as many traditional requirements as he could. He specifically designed his bank to work as well as possible with the poor, whatever it took. If a requirement blocked out the poor, he simply got rid of it. No collateral, no credit checks, not even a written contract. It was revolutionary. The system is based entirely on trust, and the amazing thing about it is that it works. According to bank officials, 97% of the loans given out to the poor are paid back in full, a payback rate that has confounded the expectations of conventional bankers. Over the years, the bank has given out more than $13 billion in loans to over 8.4 million borrowers, helping to improve communities all across rural Bangladesh. And the system is clearly working. Since 1992, the poverty rate in Bangladesh has dropped from a staggering 56% to just 31% today. While the poverty rate is still high, it is moving in the right direction. The basic belief of Muhammad Yunus is simple. Poor people have enormous untapped potential. And by lending them money, we help them break the cycle of poverty, and we can empower them to become constructive and contributing members to society in a way that benefits the entire nation and perhaps the world. The poor don't have to be a burden. In fact, they can be an incredible resource. It is a powerful idea and one that has proved to be extremely successful. Muhammad Yunus created a worldwide movement. There are now numerous banks that specialize in microloans, and there are microcredit programs in nearly 100 countries all across the world. As of the recording of this video in 2014, Muhammad Yunus is now 72 years old, and he continues to work with the poor and develop new ideas to help them succeed. He is a revolutionary thinker and a role model for our time.
Okay, well, what's your thought on that? What was his insight that led him to this idea that, hey, maybe there's a way we can help these people get out of poverty? What was the insight that he had?
Their own businesses.
Yeah, giving them money to start their own businesses because they had no access to it any other way, right? And it's, again, as he pointed out, these were people that were already working really hard. If they were able to do something that would improve their lives, let's let them do that. And if $27 is a mechanism to make that happen, why not? I thought the part that was also really remarkable was this 97% payback rate. Nobody anticipated that was going to happen. I mean, that rivals some of the best banks today that you would go to if you were to get a car loan or a mortgage. So clearly, these people are just as dedicated as doing the right thing as well. They just needed a little bit of a mechanism to be able to make that work. So the innovation for me at this point was certainly Yunus's observation that poor people aren't poor because of anything other than the circumstances that they're in relative to the system that they have to survive within. And by changing the system, then you give them access to capital and that allows them to change their lives. And now he's had this impact across the world, as well as all the other organizations that have started to do exactly the same thing, like this Kiva organization that I know people are very familiar with. And now it's all over the place, and it's a great way of sort of moving things in the right direction from a social perspective. Okay, so that's a good story. But we all know that innovation isn't easy, and I'm going to ask you a quick question after this, but Meg Whitman, who used to run eBay, for example, said basically that entrepreneurs and innovators get a kick out of screwing up the status quo. They spend a tremendous amount of time thinking about how to change the world, and as they brainstorm, they like to ask, if we did this, what would happen? So that's a big part of where innovation is going to come from, this idea of really challenging the way things are. Now, of course, that's always tricky for those of us that work for somebody else, because if you're constantly challenging what your company is doing in the markets that it's in or the products that it provides, that can be a tricky situation for you to be in from a political perspective in terms of how can you sort of make sure your own career path isn't totally derailed by constantly questioning what upper management is trying to do. So how would your career or your company view this sort of constant challenging of the status quo if that's what you wanted to go do? Some companies are embracing that quite a bit right now. We talked earlier about those companies that feel that innovation is critical to their success are more willing to ask those kinds of questions. And they're really looking forward to people within the company to ask those kinds of questions of what if, why can't we do it this way? Or why have we always done it the way we've been doing it? And that brings up this issue. If you're an entrepreneur, you're not working for anybody else just yet. So you either have your own money that you get to work with, or you have investor money that you get to work with. And if you're successful, everybody wins, nobody asks any questions, and life is good for both you and the investors for the most part. If you fail, well, the investors already know that failure is just a part of being an entrepreneur and taking lots of risk on new ventures. And so for the most part, they say, unless there was some mistake we made in analyzing what this company was going to go do, it didn't quite work out for whatever reason, let's just go start another business and see if we can't do it right the next time around. There isn't a lot of what I would call pointing fingers and things along those lines. Much different, interesting. I was telling Ania that I had my German advisor from my old PhD days visiting us for the last week, and we were talking about America's culture of failure is okay versus what he always experienced in Germany, where failure is not necessarily okay, and therefore you take a much more conservative approach towards how you develop new products than maybe the high-flying entrepreneurs that we might know about in this country. So there's a lot of cultural differences with this as well. Okay, well, intrapreneurs, those of us that work for somebody else also trying to start new products, as we've talked about, hey, if we're successful, then life is great. We get to launch a new business. We get to launch a new product that we have a lot to do with. Maybe we get a promotion. Maybe the management says, you know, Will did such a great job. We're going to give him this next new project to go run with. But if we fail, what happens? Well, then it goes back to what's the environment that your company has if you fail or not. Is it accepting of all that as just this is the way it goes? Or is it something that maybe you have to find yourself a new job at the end of the day? So it can be very tricky from a career path perspective how much you want to challenge the status quo without really knowing how willing is your company going to adapt to some of the things that you might want to bring up. I see a few of you shaking your head, so maybe you get a sense of our company is very wide open and really looking forward to new things, new changes of how to do things better and new improved ways of processing things, for example. So hopefully that's the case that for the companies you get to work with. Innovation isn't easy for a lot of different reasons. Let's talk about Alexander Graham Bell. So I think we talked about this, or Dean Kamen talked about this a little bit in the movie Slingshot. Here's just a shot of Alexander Graham Bell. He developed sort of a different way of using the electrical signals that were coming off of a telegraph system, and he was able to create some sort of device that actually could pass voice over a wire. And we're all familiar with the famous line, "Mr. Watson, come here, I want to see you," which happened way back. Actually, I didn't realize it was this early, but way back in 1876. With that idea, Bell recognized that he was an inventor. He wasn't necessarily an innovator. That's when he went to the Western Union Company and said, "I'll sell you the patent for $100,000. And if you remember from the movie, the result was that the management of Western Union said, "This is a really great idea, but it's just a toy. We can't ever see this being anything useful other than just some sort of fun thing to have around. Well, that turned out to be a big problem for Western Union because shortly afterwards, the Bell Telephone Company was launched in 1877, the year after this discovery. And within just a short period of time, they had more than 150,000 people signed up with telephones in their houses. And shortly thereafter that, Bell made his first long-distance telephone call from New York to Chicago, and that changed communications forever. And as the story goes, Western Union looked back and said, we should have paid $25 million for that patent, not $100,000 that was offered for us because it's so valuable at the time. Well, now Western Union is still trying to figure out what their real mission in life is, and Bell Telephone certainly did a lot of business over the remaining 100 years or so. Here's another interesting example, okay? It's a lot of work sometimes to do this. We're all familiar with Thomas Edison coming up with the idea of the light bulb. Well, the light bulb was around for a lot longer before Edison came around, but Edison's big breakthrough had to do with how can I make the light bulb actually last long enough to be useful? And after a long period of time, he came up with the idea that if we used a tungsten filament, then the tungsten filament within an evacuated glass chamber, the tungsten filament would last much, much longer than everything else, and now the light bulb becomes a very practical device that you can use to light your house and shop and building and streets and everything else. However, and the story goes, Edison's search for this long-lasting tungsten filament took 10,000 efforts before he finally got it right. So it was a combination of looking at some really interesting science, but then sort of the heuristic approach of just try a million different ways until one of them is going to work. And he had a whole army of scientists working in his labs at the Edison Research Lab, and eventually they came up with the idea. So again, just took a long time before he finally got it right. And yet, when he did get it right, it changed the entire industry. Here's another person that we're going to see a little bit more later on. Dyson, I don't know, are you familiar with the Dyson vacuum cleaner? This person is not only a really great inventor, he's also a fabulous marketing person because he's now on TV in his own ads talking about the advantages of his Dyson sort of turbo vacuum cleaner, if you will. And if you go through and look at what he actually did starting in the early 90s, I believe it is that it took him 5,127 prototypes before finally he got the answer that said, now we've got it right. So that took a long time, and it took a lot of effort to get to this point. All going back to the idea of it rarely occurs in some of this aha moment that now I can figure out that tungsten will work, or now I can understand why the sort of technology that goes in the Dyson vacuum cleaner is better. It took a long time for him to kind of come up with that approach. So let me just summarize, and then we're going to take a short break. Innovation, we know, is vital for growth, but it just isn't easy. And if you remember, Dean Kamen's idea was getting people to get to a place they have never been before is very hard. Innovation is a very difficult, frustrating process. We know that we need it for long-term growth of the company, but it takes a lot of time. I don't know how long 10,000 iterations of an experiment for a filament would be, but I can imagine that was quite a long period of time. And sometimes people don't even know it's an innovation until it's already in the marketplace. This is certainly the telephone example with Western Union. Western Union didn't see the potential in all this. Bell did. And we know the rest is history. So with that, let's take a 5-minute break, and we'll come back and talk about the next step, which is sort of the different types of innovations that are out there.